how were the liturgical celebrations? Talaga niyo po ba kung ganito maintindihan ng mga tao ang mga sakramento? Hindi kaya sila makikipag-unahan, no? Sa pagtanggap ng binyag, halimbawa, pagdala sa binyag ng kanilang mga anak, ng kumpir, pagsisimba, araw-araw siguro, hindi lang linggo-linggo. Because that is what the sacraments do for us. Because that is what the feasts and seasons do for us. Ipinututong tayo sa pagbuhay at walang patid na daloy ng buhay at pagliligtas. Because here and now of the celebration, in the holy day, the today of the celebration, the work that Christ accomplished for our redemption is present, available, and accessible. Kumusta po kayo? Gising pa kayo? Kaya po, hindi ka takatanga nga, no? Huh? Halimbawa, sa gabi ng Pasko, we don't hesitate to acclaim, Odies, Christus natus est. Today is born our Savior, Christ the Lord. Pwede po bang magsinungaling sa liturgiya? Hindi, di ba? Dapat, yung totoo lang at pawang katotohanan lang. If we dare to acclaim, Christ is born today. Kailanman ipinagdiriwang natin ang Pasko, ibig sabihin, we believe that the mystery of His incarnation, of His becoming one of us, human beings, no, is there present, available for us to draw grace from. And on Easter Sunday, we don't hesitate to say, to acclaim, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Wala pong anything man nangyari dyan. Those are our liturgical texts as they are found in the Roman Missal. Ito pa po, sa ating breviario, no? As we celebrate the solemnity of Epiphany, for example, the antiphon for the Catechetical of Mary is this. Again, baka kala nyo para lang magawa ko yung ma-affirm ko, no? That today, the work of our redemption is accomplished, kaya inulit-ulit ko yung presensya ng salitang today dyan. Pati po yan, walang editing yan. Totoo. That in the antiphon for the Magnificat or the Solemnity of Epiphany, three times the word today appears. Three mysteries mark this holy day. Today the star leads the Magi to the infant Christ. Today water is changed into wine for the wedding feast. Today Christ wants to be baptized by John in the River Jordan to bring us salvation. Why do we say that if we do not believe that the work of redemption accomplished by Christ is made present, available, accessible to us in our liturgical celebration? At kung hindi natin pinaniniwalaan yun, big question mark, ano po ang pinapasa natin sa ating mga lituruan? Sa mga formante natin? Sa mga batang kinakatekize natin? So much so that CCC 95 says in clear terms, the Church reads and relieves the great events of salvation history in the today of her liturgy. Again, no editing down there. And this is our catechism of the Catholic Church. Kaya, sana po walang nag-iisip sa inyo, naku, punto de vista lang ni Joyan bilang nagtapos sa PIL o kaya nagtapos sa Liturgical Institute. Hindi po. Hindi lang ito isang particular na perspective. Okay? Kundi ito po talaga ang pinaniniwalaan ng simbahan. As a matter of fact, this is what is enshrined in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. The Church believes and reveals the great events of salvation history in the today of her liturgy. And it continues, but this also demands that catechesis help the faithful to open themselves to a spiritual understanding of the economy of salvation as the Church's liturgy reveals it and enables us to live it. Napakasarap pong isipin yun, ano? Then, paano ba pinabalik? Ang sarap po, nung ma-realize siya, that the church reads and relieves the great events of salvation history in the today of her liturgy, making it present, accessible, available. Kaya lang, lalo na po para sa atin, nasa ganitong ministry, it has a great demand. But these demands, the catechesis help the faithful to open themselves to the spiritual understanding of the economy of salvation as the church's liturgy reveals it and enables us to live it. May paliwanag na po ba natin ito sa ating mga kormani? Sa ating mga katekista sa parokya? But why is greater emphasis of Vatican II on the need to understand liturgy or the sacraments, the liturgical feasts and seasons, with their intimate relationship with salvation history? CCC 97 also offers an answer. It says, because in the liturgy of the New Covenant, every liturgical action, especially the celebration of the Eucharist and the sacraments, is an encounter between Christ and the Church. That intimate relationship between liturgy and salvation history just has to be made clear to all of us. From us, formators and teachers. And made clear also to those we are teaching. In order to be able to understand, believe, and take comfort in the fact that the liturgy, the Eucharist especially, is an encounter between Christ and the Church. Kung sa ating pagliliwang, sumasa atin si Kristo, nakakatagpo natin pati ang paniginampanan para sa ating kaligtasan. Therefore, the liturgy, every liturgical celebration is an encounter. And CCC reminds us to emphasize that. Every sacramental celebration should be understood and experienced as an encounter with the Lord and what He did for our redemption. Every sacrament, every liturgical feast, every liturgical season. It continues, the liturgical assembly derives its unity from the communion of the Holy Spirit who gathers the children of God into the one body of Christ. This assembly transcends racial, cultural, social, indeed, all human affinities. In other words, kung titingnan po natin, ano po ang pinapatunguhan ng salvation history? What was it for? Why did Christ do what He did? And why does the Church continue to do what she does? I believe no one will question us if we say, it is for God to build us up into His covenant with people. Because He wants to form us into His people of the covenant. Lahat ng nangyari sa kasaysayan ni Abraham, ni Moses, ng mga propeta, lahat ng ginagawa ng ating Panginoong Hesus Kristo na nababasa sa mga ebanghelyo, lahat ng ginawa ng mga apostoles na binabasa natin sa Acts of the Apostles, all of these are in view of forming out of us God's covenanted people. And so, at this point po, I would like to share almost an excursus, no? I will try to make reference. I want to make reference to the Eucharist in order to use it as a kind of an illustration of the points that we have said earlier. But at the same time, I have a second part in my agenda. I just want to share a little something from the International Eucharistic Congress. One part of the theological document of the International Eucharistic Congress deals with this. What is the Eucharist there? It is to form the body of Christ. But the phrase body of Christ applies to both the bread and the assembly. And so, to the question, why did Christ institute the Eucharist? A related question would be, and why has the Church been always trying to be faithful to Christ? Christ command to do it in His memory. I think it is that. Okay, the primary reason for celebrating the Eucharist is the church is meant to be constantly built up into the body of Christ. The bread and the wine have to become the body of Christ in order to form those who partake of it into the body of Christ. The double meaning po, yung phrase na body of Christ. It applies, it refers to both the bread and the wine over which the prayer of epiclesis has been said. It also applies to the people and the effect of partaking of the body and blood of Christ. Pamilyar po tayo sa tinatawag natin double epiclesis. No? Yung consecratory epiclesis and communion epiclesis. What is the consecratory epiclesis? The first one. The Holy Spirit is involved upon the gifts of bread and wine. So that, siguro nabanggit ni Father Gustilo kanina to, because I understand he spoke on the role of the Holy Spirit in the life and mission of the church, no? Okay. The Holy Spirit is involved upon the gifts of bread and wine so that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Ang tinapay at alam na kanina lang ay inialay, buhanap pag-aw. Biyaya ng Diyos at bunga ng paggawa. Magiging katawan at dugo ng ating Panginoon. Paano? Sa pamamagitan ng Espiritu Santo na hiningi natin mula sa Ama sa pamamagitan ng Yesu Kristo. Pangalawa, the same Holy Spirit is involved upon this family so that by partaking of the body and blood of Christ, they may be filled with His Holy Spirit and become one body, one spirit in Christ. In other words, it is the same Holy Spirit whom the priest invokes later in the Eucharistic prayer so that he may also transform those who will receive the body and blood of Christ unto the image of Christ Himself, one body, one spirit in Christ. As early as the first century, it is said that the Didache is almost contemporary to the Gospel according to St. John. Ganito na po ang paniniwala ng simbahan, that the liturgy is celebrated, especially the Eucharist is celebrated, in order to constantly build up the body of Christ among the community of the faithful. Kaya po, yung isang revered prayer that comes from the so-called Didache, no? An ancient document, hindi po yung publication na recent lang, no? Okay, the Didache, dating around 80 to 90 AD, okay? A certain portion of it says, as this broken bread was carried over the hills, and then when gathered became one mass, one loaf, so may thy church be gathered from the ends of the earth into thy kingdom. May thy church be gathered. Okay? And it has been so treasured by the church, believing that it truly is the reason why we continue to celebrate the Eucharist in the memory of what the Lord has done for us. At bakit hindi ko masasabi yan? It has been multiplied in so many other songs like Katulad ng Habutil na Matitipon Upang pating pinapay na nagbibigay buhay. Hindi pa nalangin natin. Kami na ay matipon din at malimpay mong bibig. Why do we celebrate the Eucharist? Upang tayo'y maging iisang katawan ng Panginoon. Ano pa? Karami yan. Bread that was sown. Bread that was sown in our hills and valleys. Now harvested becomes one. Come, O Lord, gather your people, O God, into the feast of your love. I'm sure yung iba sa inyo meron pang ibang maiisip. Bakit? Because this prayer, this tiny prayer, really, it's very tiny, madaling hindi mapansin. But it has been so revered and so believed by the church that we have enshrined it in so many of our liturgical songs. Tama po ba ako? So, again, why did Christ institute the Eucharist on the night he was betrayed. Why has the church continued to be faithful to the mandate of Christ on that night? Do this in memory of me. I believe, and I hope I share the same belief with all of us here. It is to build us up into this one body. For the early church, what was most crucial about the Eucharistic celebration is that it caused them to gather together. Bakit kailangan lagi silang mag-celebrate, mag-diwan ng misa, ng Eucharistia? Kasi kung sila mag-diwan ng Eucharistia, edi matitipon sila. We have to gather together. And their faith conviction was that it is in being gathered together. In the original term is ecclesia, no? That salvation comes upon them. Their faith conviction was that it is in being gathered together that salvation comes upon them. Allow me to explain myself. It is in seeing themselves as the one body of Christ. Body ha, katawan. It is in seeing themselves as the one body of Christ that the healthy members felt sensitive to the pain and sufferings of the sick members and thus impelled to help them in their needs. Ano po kasabihan ng Pilipino ang naisip niyo dyan? Sakit ng kalingkingan, ramdam sakit ng buong katawan. Sumasa atin ang kaligtasan dahil ang Eucharistia ay binubuo tayo bilang isang katawan, isang pamilya na kung saan ang sakit ng pinakamaliit man sa mga bahagi ng katawan niya, ramdam ng iba pa. At hindi sila papayag na manatiling nasa sakit yung bahagi niyo. And therefore, they felt impelled to help them in their needs. Nasusundan niyo po? The Eucharist, in other words, generates social justice by forming the gathered assembly into the one body of Christ where division, factions, and apathy over the suffering are called into question. We call ourselves body of Christ. Kaya hindi natin nararamdaman ang sakit na dinaranas ng mga dukha, ng mga may sakit, ng mga nalulupig ang kanilang karapatan. I want to say that the Eucharist exhorts towards social justice. Yes, you might say, by motivating us to think of the poor and serve that the way Christ did. I think to some extent the Eucharist does that. It motivates us towards social justice by motivating us to think of the poor and to serve them the way Christ did. But I say, I think even more, the Eucharist exhorts towards social justice by reminding us of who we are. Sino nga ba tayo? The body of Christ. By reminding us of who we are, the body of Christ, and what it cost Christ to form us into His body. What did it cost Him? Everything, everything that He is. Kenosis, self-emptying. Now, from theological foundation that we have seen so far, we are brought to some liturgical principles that I think are very useful to us in our ministry. Okay, a number of liturgical principles are taken up here, naturally emanate from that theological foundation, but with the limited time that we have, allow me to just discuss two of them. The first is, sa nakita po natin, di ba? It becomes clear that liturgy is a celebration of our salvation. Celebration in the sense of making present and available, accessible. The liturgy is a celebration of our salvation and it should be accomplished and experienced as such. Hindi ko po inaalis sa taas yung prinsipyo, no? As we discuss its implications. Characterized by joy, order, recollection, restfulness, and a spirit of gratitude, liturgy is praise and thanksgiving to God for the salvation which Christ has accomplished for us and which the Church perpetuates today in the power of the Holy Spirit. In fact, as he said and says, in the liturgy, the whole public worship is performed by the mystical body of Jesus Christ, that is, by the head and his members. And this principle has real demands on the way on the celebrant's manner of presiding. Nararanasan ba ang liturgiya, ang isa bilang isang celebration ng kaligtasan natin? It has real demands as well on the way the word should be proclaimed. That same principle has its real demands on the music of the liturgy and its rendition. Di ko ba? It has its real demands even on how the place of the celebration should be set up. It has real demands on the quality of the people's involvement in the liturgical celebration. That is why our Constitution tells us that pastors are therefore enjoined when the liturgy is celebrated. Something more is required than the mere observance of the laws governing valid and licit celebration. It is their duty also to ensure that the faithful can be released together. Actively engaged in the rite and enriched by its effects. For their part, the people should be encouraged to take part by means of acclamations, responses, psalmody, antiphons, and songs, as well as by actions, gestures, and bodily attitudes. And at the proper times, all should observe a reverent silence. And then another principle that naturally emanates from this is that liturgy indeed demands the full, active, and conscious participation of all the faithful in liturgical celebrations. This great man here, mukhang lolo, no, he's a great Benedictine theologian. His name is Odo Castle. In his theological synthesis called The Mystery of Liturgy, he articulates the mystery of Christian worship this way. He asserts that the faithful assembled for worship by performing the rite take part in the saving act made present precisely by the rite and thereby win salvation. Anong nakikita ng mata? Sila'y nakikisampot sa pagdiriwang. They listen to the word, they respond, they sing, they do the actions, they do the gestures. That is what we see them doing, taking part in the rite. But that which is visible to our eyes actually means something so profound, that they also take part in that work of redemption that is being celebrated, the saving act that Christ did for our redemption. They are participating as well in the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. They are participating as well in the forgiving and reconciling ministry of the Lord. The faithful assembled for worship by performing the rite take part in the saving act made present precisely by the rite and thereby win salvation. The very nature of the liturgy as a making present of Christ's work for our redemption in rites, word, and signs asks, therefore, that the Christian people, whenever they are gathered together for liturgical celebrations, they are fully aware of what they're doing, actively engaged in the rite, and enriched by its effects. They should not be there as strangers or silent spectators. On the contrary, through a good understanding of the rites of prayers, they should take part in the sacred action, conscious of what they're doing, with devotion and full collaboration. If you've been wondering, saan ba galing yung phrase ng Perlitus et Preces? By means of rites and prayers, SC 48. It was not made up by me, it was not made up by Father Ansgar or anyone else. But we find it in SC 48. So, the faithful should not be there as strangers or silent spectators, but on the contrary, the good understanding of the rites and prayers, they should take part in the sacred action. The various ministries within the liturgy, beginning from that of the presiding celebrant, are to help the assembly accomplish that kind of participation. Since this concerns first of all the clergy, to whom belongs the chief duty of a faithful dispenser of the mysteries of God, my favorite title, the priests of po mga fathers, ito po yung tabo rin binibigay sa inyo ng sacrosanctum concilium. Faithful dispensers of the mysteries of God. And so, by instruction and edifying leadership in liturgical celebrations, how important is the liturgical formation of the clergy, both in seminary and in the course of their ministry. Sabi ko po sa inyo kanina, after the vision itself, which is enshrined in SC 14, immediately after that, hindi pa tayo tapos sa SC 14, we already begin to see an implication of that. That pastors of souls, therefore, should be imbued with the spirit of the liturgy in order that they will be able to bring the people of God towards that kind of active, full participation in the liturgy. That's 14, huh? 15, 16, 17, they discuss the kind of liturgical formation that seminarians should have. What's the next number? 18. What does it say? Liturgical formation in seminaries, 14 to 17, so that future priests may become thoroughly imbued with the spirit and power of the liturgy and undertake to give instruction about it. And then, the continuing liturgical formation of priests, SC 18, both secular and religious who are already working in the Lord's vineyard, hindi pa tapos ang pangangailangan ng liturgical formation. So that they may understand ever more fully what it is they are doing when they perform sacred rites. They are to be aided to live the liturgical life and to share it with the faithful entrusted to their care. Saka pa lang, darating tayo sa SC 19 that speaks of the liturgical instruction of the faithful. Bakit ito na yun? Eh kasi ang ating mga pastors ang dapat magsagawa ng pagbibigay ng paghuhukom sa mga mananampalataya. The liturgical instruction of the faithful. The faithful so far as possible should be enabled to understand the liturgical celebrations with ease and to take part in them fully, actively, and as befits a community. Napansin niyo na po ba yung ganyang sequence ng sacrosanctum concilium? The vision. Then, because it is our pastors of souls who are primarily expected to lead the people towards that, and so it deals first with their formation in the seminary. And then, their continuing formation even while already in the ministry. And then, the liturgical formation of the faithful. For this, the same constitution proposes the following means. Noble simplicity. Let liturgical rites be simple, clear, within the people's powers of comprehension. This explains Vatican II's promotion of the use of vernacular languages in liturgical celebrations. Okay, homiletics, homilies. Salamat sa Diyos, meron tayo na yung lumabas na directory for homiletics. The ministry of preaching is to be fulfilled with exactitude and fidelity, drawing its content mainly from scriptural and liturgical sources, and its character should be that of a proclamation of God's wonderful works in the history of salvation. The mystery of Christ ever being present and active within us, especially in the celebration of the liturgy. Liturgical catechesis. Instruction, which is more explicitly liturgical, should be given to the faithful in a variety of ways. Ano bang pagkakaiba ng liturgical catechesis at saka yung walang liturgical? Halimbawa, liturgical catechesis on baptism, o kaya, in comparison with catechesis on baptism, alam niyo po ba yung pagkakaiba? Liturgical or sacramental catechesis. Dahil po walang masyadong oras, sasabihin ko na po, sirit. Okay? Catechesis on baptism, you can base it on just about anything. You can base it on the work of Lawler. You can base it on CFC, CCC. Pero pag sinabing liturgical or sacramental catechesis of baptism, ibig sabihin, you are basing your teaching of the sacrament of baptism on the rites and prayers with which we celebrate baptism. Through rites and prayers. Yung po yung tinatawag natin properly, sacramental liturgical catechesis. Later on, in the process, baka kailanganin nga po natin ang tulong ng CCC, ng CFC, ng gawa ni Michael Lawler, etc., ni Father Amstar Chibongo, to help us articulate. Pero it remains that the first recourse that we should have, the rites and the prayers with which we celebrate the sacraments or the feast and season. Yan po yung tinatawag na mystagogical catechesis din. Napaka-basic po, no, ng dahilan kung bakit ganon. Because liturgy, the sacraments, the feast and seasons are in the nature of a celebration. And so, our primary basis for teaching them should be the elements of the celebration. Liturgical catechesis should also help to direct the minds of the faithful towards the feast of the Lord, whereby the mysteries of salvation are celebrated in the course of the year. Various postcards in your documents look to the teaching activity of the 4th and 5th century bishop mystagogues. Ambrose, John Chrysostom, ito po kasi yung topic ng aking dissertation, no? Kaya kabisado po sila. Ambrose of Milan, John Chrysostom, si Cyril of Jerusalem, at saka po si Theodore of Suestia. Okay? Magpahuling, nag-inagdag po si St. Augustine of Hippo. Okay? The 4th and 5th century bishop mystagogues. No? The various post-conciliar documents of the church love to look back at how they give their teaching the faithful the sacraments as paradigm for the content and method of liturgical catechesis today. How do po sila nagturo? Making constant reference to the celebration. Kaya nga po yan ang naging pangalan ng ganyang klase ng pagtuturo sa mga sakramento o sa mga kapistahan ng sakraman. Mystagogical catechesis. Iiwan ko na po yun, baka mapahaba lang tayo lalo. No? Pag nagsimula po sa mystagogia, naliliba ka rin. Okay, so isa pong dokumento ay yung directory for masses with children. Okay, tingnan niyo po yung mystagogical tone niya, no? The Directory for Masses with Children provides the catechetical instruction on the liturgy, especially on the Mass, must be given to children with a view to encouraging them to participate in it actively, consciously, and genuinely. It continues, it must be geared towards the age and intelligence of the children. It must be aimed at conveying through the principal rites and prayers the meaning of the Mass, particularly as a sharing in the life of the Church. So, tingnan niyo po, hindi lang dahil hilig ko o hindi lang sa tagalang inaral ko. That's why I am promoting this way of teaching the sacraments and the feasts and seasons of the Church and other liturgical celebrations. It has been the way the Church taught the sacraments. Also, another document is the Instruction Eucharistico Mysterium on the worship of the Eucharistic Mystery. Those who have charge of the religious instruction of children, especially parents, parish priests, and teachers, should be careful when they are introducing them gradually to the mystery of salvation, to give emphasis to the instruction of the Mass, aiming to convey the meaning of the Mass through the principal rites and prayers. Liturgical catechesis, ito po yung sinasabi ko. Look, CCC 1075 explicitly tells us, our teaching the sacraments today, the feast and seasons of the liturgical year, etc., etc., must be in the manner of mystagogia. Liturgical catechesis, to quote 1075, aims to initiate people into the mystery of Christ. It is mystagogy by proceeding from the visible to the invisible, from the sign to the thing signified, from the sacraments to the mysteries. Okay. Mukhang ito po'y napag-aralan nyo na kanilang umaga. Okay. Matutulong po sa ating gawain ng pagtuturo ng salita ng Diyos, ng ating doktrina ng Kristiyana, no? Ay encouraging study of the Scriptures and then promoting a sense of community within the parish. This should be sought above all with the common celebration of the Sunday Mass in the parish church. Ito po yung na-assign sa akin na isang talk sa IBC, no? The Sunday Eucharist. And then promoting a sense of community within the parish should be also sought by organizing common activities among various groups according to age level, concerns, occupations, advocacies, outside the liturgical celebrations. Because this can have a real impact on the sense of community with which the liturgy is to be celebrated. Sports activities for children and youth, perhaps. Outreach activities by various professional groups, etc. Promoting common celebration of the liturgy of the hours, at least Lords and Vespers, the two pages of the day. Establishment of a liturgy commission, okay, that will also make for its concern liturgical catechesis. Okay. And I would like to end with this. We have brought forward some recommendations on how to bring our people towards the realization of the vision of Sacrosanct Concilium and the liturgical renewal that it set in motion. Liturgical catechesis, etc. But it is not to be forgotten that the best and most effective means to promote the liturgical sensibility and consciousness of the Christian community through actual experiences of celebrations that are in keeping with the dignity of the liturgy as the highest form of encounter between God and His people, and with the identity of the Christian faithful as the royal priestly people of God. Maraming parang po akong recommender on how to raise the liturgical life of our people, promote active, full, and conscious participation of our people in the liturgy. But above all, it is by always making sure that the liturgical celebrations that we prepare and celebrated with and for our people are celebrations that are in keeping with the dignity of our highest formal encounter with God, and that are in keeping with their identity as the Christian faithful who are the royal priestly people of God. That in all things, God may be glorified.